Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Spring Creek Church. Come on in. Sorry we don't have 3,000 donuts in the foyer today. But y'all did good by consuming 2,800 of them last week. So congratulations. Well, my name is Brian Mitchell. I'm the programming pastor here at Spring Creek, and we are glad that you have chosen to be here today, the Sunday after Easter. And so I do have some good news for you as we start today. Do you like good news? All right, here's the good news. He's still risen. All right, amen. He is still risen. And that is why we are here today. That is why we worship Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So here at Spring Creek, we love praising and worshiping our risen Savior. And so we love doing that through music. I don't know if you noticed that or not, but we love music here. And we use that to worship our God, to praise our Savior for what he's done for us. And in just a minute, we're going to sing three songs that convey that message of hope and truth, that Jesus died for us, that he rose again, and our hope is now in him for eternal life. And so I'm looking forward to that this morning. I hope you are too. We'd love to hear from you. If you are here as a guest or if you're a regular as well, we would love to hear from you. In the back of your pew there, there's a little communication card. You can fill that out, share a prayer request with us or a praise, a little bit about yourself, and you can put them in one of the boxes at the exits of the sanctuary this morning. Or you can also text us. You can text the letters SCC to the number 262-288-2827, and you'll get some reply texts, and you can just follow the prompts on those. Also, if you have questions about anything related to Spring Creek here today, there are some very nice people at the information kiosks in the foyer. They can help answer any questions you might have or give you some literature on some of the programs that are going on here. And there's a lot going on here at Spring Creek. We're excited about some things coming up. We've got a special baptism service tonight at 4 o'clock. A lot of students and adults that are just going to be declaring their faith in the Lord publicly tonight at 4. And then next Sunday, we're celebrating our 60th year of our children's program called Awana. This can be a great celebration next Sunday. And I don't know, there's a huge rummage sale going on here as well on May 7th. And so we can all work together on that. So you can check all that stuff on our website, springcreekonline.com. It's going to be a great day today here at Spring Creek. We're glad you're here. So let's start off with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for giving us this time together today to gather, to worship you in this place, to reflect on what you've done for us, and to reply in gratitude. And so, Lord, I pray that you will bless this time. I pray that you will guide us through this morning, through this great day at this church. We love you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I echo what he says. Why don't we stand up and sing about Christ being risen from the dead? That's so amazing today.
Let no one caught in sin remain inside the lie of inward shame. We fix our eyes upon the cross and run to him who showed great love and bled for us. Freely you've bled for us. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Scoffer's crown, no burden great. from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead. We are one with him again. Come awake, come awake. Come and rise up from the grave.
You will reign forevermore. The victory.
is done, we'll see your face bright as the sun. We'll bow before the King of Kings, oh God, forever we. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on.
And there proclaim
my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
encouraged that you're here today. You always wonder after a great Easter weekend, will anyone be back the next week? And just so you know, the reason we celebrate, reason we gather on Sunday is because we're celebrating the resurrection every single Sunday. That's why we don't worship on the Sabbath anymore. That's why we worship on the Lord's Day. It's because he rose. So I'm really, really excited to see you here. It was the largest attended Good Friday service and Resurrection Sunday service in the history of our church last weekend. So praise the Lord. John chapter 9, please. Let's open our Bibles to John chapter 9. How many of you have watched a baseball game or had kids watch, play a baseball game, or you've played baseball or you've watched baseball? Let me see your hands. Okay. When a little kid is at the plate, and he's holding the bat, or she's holding the bat, and they get a walk. That is, you know, somehow there's four balls, and they walk. What do the parents, or I should say, what do the grandparents say to the kid? What? Good eye. Good eye. You didn't swing at a ball. That's good eyes. And today in John chapter 9, we're going to talk about how to have good eyes so you can see. So you can see life clearly. So you can see Jesus clearly. John chapter 9 is among the most dramatic chapters in all of John's gospel. There's a lot of things going on here dramatically. I have marked so many things in John chapter 9. Not to say chapter 8 and chapter 10 are special either. They are. But John chapter 9 is chucked full of what may be one of the most rich chapters in all of John's gospel in terms of literature, word usage, word repetition, and lessons for our time today. Now, when you get to the chapter, you'll know that Jesus is going to heal a blind man. I think last week I announced that our subject today was the divine ophthalmologist, right? Where Jesus allows a blind man to see. Jesus did lots of miracles. They confirmed who he was. It made it very clear that divine power was the source of those miracles. But every time Jesus did a miracle. He didn't just perform a miracle so that we would understand and the people would understand he truly was God. He did it with a spiritual meaning in mind so that we could learn a lesson in addition to the lesson that he's from God. There's an additional bonus lesson that we all must learn every time there's a miracle in any one of the Gospels. Now, blind people were quite common in Jesus' day. Blindness was a common malady, problem for all of them. Health, cleanliness, issues related to our eyes were not specialized in those days, so it happened all the time. I counted up, I think, 5 different times in the New Testament Jesus healed someone who was blind. And he clearly was addressing a problem that was plenteous in his day. And all of these physical meanings and all of these physical healings, however, something far greater happens. Because I want you, and we're going to read the text, all of the chapter. I'm going to read it almost as fast as I can to get through it. But as we read it, I want you to know that something far greater than the opening of the blind man's eyes happens in John chapter 9. If you leave here today thinking that the primary miracle of John chapter 9 is Jesus heals the blind man's eyes, I have failed as a pastor. I want you to see it. Are you ready? Here we go. As he went along, he saw a blind man from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Well, neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus. "But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." And having said this, he spit on the ground. Yes, it says he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "and wash in the pool of Siloam," which that word means sent. And so the man went and washed and came home seeing. And his neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" And some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he just looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." Verse 10, "How then were your eyes opened?" they demanded. He replied, "Well, the man they called Jesus had some mud and put it on my eyes, and he told me to go to Siloam and wash, and I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is that man?" they asked him. "I don't know," he said. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. And he said, "Well, he put mud on my eyes, and I washed. Now I see." And some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner do such miraculous signs?" So they were divided, and finally they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him?" "It was your eyes he opened." And the man replied, "Well, he's a prophet." The Jews still did not believe that he had been blind and received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. "Is this your son?" they asked. "Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that he can now see?" "We know he is our son," the parents answered, "and we know he was born blind. But how he can see now or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him. He's of age. He'll speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. For already the Jews had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. And that's why the parents said, well, he's of age, ask him. Verse 24, a second time they summoned the man who had been blind. Give glory to God, they said. We know this man is a, what's the text say? He's a sinner. And he replied, whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I know, I was blind. Hallelujah. That's not in the text. But now I see. Then they asked him, well, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And he answered, I've already told you, and you didn't listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciple too? Yeah, I'm glad you laughed, because there's a little sarcasm in that one, right? And they hurled insults at him and said, you are this fellow's disciples, and we are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses. But as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from. The man answered, now that's remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly man, the one who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. To this they replied, you are steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? They threw him out. And Jesus heard they had thrown him out. When he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Well, who is he, sir? The man asked. Tell me that I may believe in him. And Jesus said, you have now. What's the next word? Mark your Bible there. You've now seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking. Then the man said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, for judgment I have come into the world so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind. Some of the Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, what? Are we blind too? Jesus said, if you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains. See what I mean? It's an amazing chapter. And we're drawn to this because the text is very clear. Who brought attention to the blind man alongside of the road? As he went along, who saw the blind man? Jesus did. The text seems to indicate, John seems to indicate here, that if they were walking along the road, that the disciples would not have stopped and talked to him, but Jesus saw him, and Jesus thought, I'm going to talk to him. It was Jesus who initiated the conversation with the blind man. It was Jesus who chose to grace the blind man's life with his presence. It was Jesus who knew what was about to happen was going to be a great moment in this blind man's life, physically and spiritually. And this most well-crafted story, I counted 18 questions that are in this text. I suppose it depends on the Bible translation you have. One of them was 15, one of them was 18, and it kind of depends on how you translate a couple of words. But this chapter is filled with questions that people are asking, including Jesus. One of the great things you'll do this week is you read through this text and you're doing your 52 weeks with Jesus, which we're doing as a church. And if you're new and you want to jump along, just go to Amazon, order 52 Weeks with Jesus book, and you can have it delivered probably by tonight. I don't know how that works, but it's pretty fast. And we sold out, I think, 1,600 or so of them. And you can pick it up and follow along. But you're going to read this text this week, and I want you to just keep noticing all the questions that are here. And Jesus draws his attention to this man. I don't know, I tried to think. I'd have probably been like the disciples and said, come on, ignore that guy. We got work to do, Jesus. We've all walked by beggars. We all kind of conclude, well, they'll probably just use the money for alcohol anyway. But somehow, Jesus wasn't too self-righteous or too busy to stop and engage him with a conversation. And just as he stops, the disciples don't speak to the blind man. It's like he's not deaf, he's blind. They ask Jesus a question in the presence of the blind man that is the million-dollar question. Why is he blind? Why? Jesus, why is he? Why? All right, you stopped. Then let's deal with this because we don't know how to deal with it. Why is he blind? So in keeping with the way the text is written by John, I'm going to formulate my sermon on the basis of five questions that are asked. Here's the first one. Why do people suffer physically? Why was he blind? Now, the assumption the disciples had and that the Jews had and everyone had is anytime there was a physical problem, it's because someone sinned. Now, I don't think it's a bad question. I don't think it's wrong that the disciples asked Jesus. I'm not sure they were most sensitive to whether or not this blind man could actually hear what was going on. But this is a question we've all struggled with. Why do people suffer physically? Look, if I'm talking to a few hundred people here today and a few more online, I'm talking to somebody here today who has suffered. You've suffered physically, emotionally. You've had a moment where we're hurt really, really bad. And you've probably done the same thing and said to God, why? Would you just give me the reason why I have to go through this? It's not an inappropriate question. I think it's a fair question. Now, the answer to the question is complicated. Sometimes we suffer because of our own poor decisions, right? When you're holding the nail and your thumb is in the way and you're not real good with the hammer and you hit your thumb, you don't have to ask God why that happened. You're suffering the consequences of your own fate. You're in a tough marriage and you've made a series of poor decisions and you're suffering the consequences of that, then you don't have to ask the question why, because you know the answer is because you messed up. Sometimes when you ask why, you can look inside and go, yeah, that's right, I guess I didn't do that properly, and when that's the case, don't blame God. Repent of your sins. Receive forgiveness. And let your pain prompt you to draw closer to the Lord. Right? But there are other times where we suffer physically and you didn't sin. Your parents didn't sin. Your spouse didn't sin. It's nobody knows why. It just happened. We live in a world that's cursed by sin, and there are consequences of that curse. Sickness, disease is a consequence of the curse because Adam and Eve chose to rebel against God. And sometimes on this side of glory, we just have situations that happen to us and they hurt. And if you've had a physical or social or intellectual or mental disability in any kind or pain in any kind, instead of blaming God or your parents or your spouse or your boss or your pastor, just consider this. Our limitations might be an opportunity for God to display himself through our life to others. But the text is very clear as Jesus answered this question. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, Jesus said. This happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. Many of you know the name Johnny Erickson Tada, who as a teenager had a diving accident, broke her neck, and has spent the rest of her life paralyzed in a wheelchair. She says she suffers from great pain every single day. If you're not familiar with her story, I encourage you to read her books and get to know her story. She has taught me so much about suffering and pain and how she processes it, and how, in fact, she says she's glad the accident happened because it's drawn her so close to the Lord. Sometimes God likes to put us in a situation where the only place we can turn to is him. Doctors can't fix it. After a period of time, we come to the conclusion even God's plan is that prayer won't fix it, although sometimes I think it does. And you just have to look up and say, I need your help. I'm going to lean into your truth of who you are. I'm going to choose to draw near to you, even though I don't understand it. The Apostle Paul understood suffering, yes? The Bible says he had a thorn in the flesh. Most people think Paul's thorn in the flesh was his physical eyesight. I've heard some ideas that some people think he suffered from migraine headaches. It's possible. Some people think he had a speech impediment. Some people have suggested he had a bad mother-in-law. That was his thorn in the flesh. Some people have said maybe the thorn in the flesh were the way the Jews treated him. Whatever it was very painful to Paul and very debilitating. It hindered his ability to be effective as he thought he should be effective. And so the Bible says at least three times Paul pleaded to God. Remember? It's 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul pleaded to God, would you take this away? Please, take it away. Heal me. And Paul's very clear that God didn't answer his prayer the way he thought it might have turned out. And Paul, as he processed his lack of answer to prayer, that as he processed his painful disability that he had to suffer with, here's what Paul comes to the conclusion. Here's something we all need to work on when we're in pain. Paul says, here's what I've learned. I've learned that when my pain is great, Jesus says to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. 2 Corinthians 12. 9. Sometimes the only reason we suffer is so that we will lean into God, draw close to him, and let his power work through us. So it's not wrong to ask why we suffer. Do you know anybody else famous who asked why? Jesus did. He's hanging on the cross, remember? What did he say? my God, why have you forsaken me? Matthew 27:46. If Jesus can ask the question, we can ask the question. And now we know, as we get on this side of the resurrection, now we know the answer to the question, but God didn't speak from heaven. The Father didn't speak to the Son from heaven and say, I'll explain it to you later, Jesus. The angst in that moment was real for our Savior. And sometimes the answer doesn't come when we think it should. But here's what we know. Suffering gives God opportunities to show us His amazing grace. We heard it on Good Friday in the testimony that was given. I remember growing up, there was some new choruses coming out. We called it contemporary Christian music. Andre Crouch was one of the leaders, and he wrote a song called Through It All. And one of the little phrases goes like this, "And if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that He could solve them." Why do we suffer? Sometimes through our own bad consequences, and sometimes just to draw us close to Jesus. Another question I want to ask you from this text is verse 4. So how much time do we have? He says, as long as it is day, we must do the work of Him who sent me. But night is coming when no one can work. There's a sense of urgency in Jesus as He speaks this. He's talking about life is short. You don't have forever to think this all through and come up with a conclusion. You've got to make a decision somewhere along the way. I understand you got a day or two or a week or two to kind of work through your why questions. But you don't have forever. Somewhere along the way, we have to understand that life is much shorter than we think. And I believe God has blessed us today in this moment with living in one of some of the most exciting times in the history of the world. I didn't say it was some of the most enjoyable times. We are coming through a pandemic where we have learned our culture, our world suffers from a lack of hope. Now, I did my best to avoid it. You did your best to avoid the virus. But at the end of the day, virus or no virus, God is still on the throne and we must trust Him. And I think it's a great time for us to share the good news with others that Jesus is coming, the hour is late. We must invest our one and only life, our every opportunity we have to invest in the life of others, to invest your one and only life in a way that really matters. So that our time, our talent, and our money is invested for things that will last for eternity. The psalmist says, Lord, teach us to number our days. How much time do we have? Probably less than we think we do. And that's why there's an urgency in the story of hope. Third question is found in verse 5, where Jesus says, while I'm in the world, well, I'm the light of the world. Here's the question. Does Jesus' light shine in you? I'm the light of the world. But here's the problem. Jesus isn't always shining in the world through us. Jesus is no longer here, and the only way the light of the world shines in this world outside of creation is when He shines through you and me. And apparently, sometimes we don't shine very bright for Him. These people are clueless and oblivious and couldn't care less about the light of the world. And Jesus says, When I live in a life, there's a light to the point of the way, and a life that points out that there's something bigger in life. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And then he says, you also are the light of the world. His light is supposed to shine through our lives to a world filled with darkness. I read a story this week about a little boy who came up to the pastor and said, Pastor, you said I could invite Jesus into my heart today. And the pastor said, that's right, I did. But he said, Jesus is a man and he has a man's body. And the pastor said, that's right, he actually had a body. He was born physically and he was both the infinite God and man. And the little boy creased his brow and persisted, but I'm just a little boy. And the pastor said, well, I know you are, but if even as a little boy, you can understand Jesus and he can come into your life. And the little boy said, but if Jesus is a man and he comes into me as a little boy, he'll be sticking out all over the place. Children are very literal, you understand? And just think about it. That's exactly right. When Jesus comes into your life, he's supposed to be sticking out all over the place. So that they don't see you and me. They see Jesus living in you and me. And the message that Jesus wants us to hear in this text is, he's the light of the world. He's the one who gives light to us. He's the one who helps us see. He wants us to be a light to this world of darkness. And the way we're a light isn't just by cramming the gospel down people's throat. Here's the way you're going to be the light of Jesus this week. Just be kind to people. Be nice. Next time you're in a restaurant that has poor service, which is pretty much all of them, because they don't have enough people. The last thing we need are Christians yelling at the servers. And by the way, if you pray before you eat at your meal and you bow your head in prayer, please leave a very generous tip. I don't want them to think people who bow their heads to pray are cheapskates. Okay. Be kind, be loving, be good, and be bold, and look for opportunities to tell your story of faith. Fourth question from this text is, have your eyes ever been touched by Jesus? Verses 6 and 7, it sounds so crude to go through this journey. Like, this just doesn't sound like my idea of a good time. He spits on the ground, makes some mud. Like, boys probably like this better than girls. Can I, you know what I'm saying? Boys love to spit, especially baseball players. Have you noticed? They're always spitting. But Jesus spits on the ground, makes a little paste. He doesn't ask the man, can I put it on your eyes? He just does it. He doesn't say, do you believe me yet? Doesn't appear at this point to be a condition for the miracle. There are no preliminary conditions for healing at all. He just compassionately goes to work. And when God initiates kindness to all of us who are still in darkness, or those of us who have crossed over the line of faith, anytime God initiates his kindness to us, it's called grace, his gift to you and me. And he just does what he says. By the way, sometimes the most worshipful thing you do isn't how you sing on Sunday morning, although I want you here singing. Sometimes the most worshipful thing you can do is just when God's word says something, just obey him. The text is very clear. Jesus spit and put some mud on his eyes and said, go wash them off in the pool of Siloam. And he did. He didn't say, well, you got to be kidding me. This is the stupidest thing I've ever seen in my life. How immature. I mean, it is kind of gross. None of that happens. He just goes. And one of the words that happens over and over again in this text is eyes. The word eyes appears 9 times in this text. 6, 10, 11, 14, 15, 17, 21, 26, 30. And every time it has a personal, there's somebody's eyes it's reflecting, either a personal pronoun or a personal description. This is highly unusual to have this many times somebody's personal eyes are talked about in one small chapter. And I think it's about eyes, 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 eyes. And I think it's very clear that John chapter 9 is in this text not just about the eyes of the blind man. John chapter 9 is in this text where eyes appears 9 times so that you and I will start thinking about eyes, our eyes, and the impact Almighty God has had on our eyes. And while blindness was debilitating in that time because of the dirty water and pollutants all around, clearly the issue is he wants us to think about our eyes and the spiritual impact of our eyes and what it means to have eyes that can really see. And Jesus tells him to go to the pool of Siloam. And he sent him, the text says, he sent him to the pool of Siloam, which, what does the word Siloam mean? Sent. John, and I don't have the time to go through this all, but John, among all the other apostles or gospel writers, describes Jesus as the one sent, S-E-N-T, from God over and over again. You read John, he's the one sent. God sent me. I'm sent by God. I'm sent. I'm sent. Jesus tells him to go to the pool of Siloam. So here's the point. Could Jesus have just like said, your eyes are healed? Could he? Yes, he did. Other occasions. This time he goes through this mud and the eyes and go wash in the pool of Siloam. And John tells us what Siloam means. It's like he wants us to know the sent thing. Because he's seeing that the man who was blind is going to go to the place called Sent, and he wants him to know, you're not being healed by the pool, you're being healed by the one who sent you to a place called Sent. Everybody understood it. That's why John puts it in there, so that you and I would understand it. And then there's lots more questions that go on, verses 10 through 40, like, how were your eyes opened? He answers them. A little bit later, verse 26, how were your eyes opened? He said, I think I told you this once. You're not listening. Well, how were your eyes opened? A sinner couldn't have opened your eyes. And his answer is so sincere. It's so sweet. Whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. Here's what I know. I was blind, and now I can see. He doesn't know much. He was just a blind man sitting along the road. He hasn't had a time to even process Jesus. It's likely he's never heard Jesus speak before. But he sure got his attention that day. And he knew you can't just write this guy off as a sinner. And they didn't want to hear it, and they didn't want to listen, and he knows that they don't want to listen. You don't want to become one of his disciples too, do you? What a great line. And they said, no, we're not his disciple. We're a disciple of Moses. We can't be a disciple of anybody else, which is not true. Listen, Moses looked for the day that Jesus would come. Abraham looked for the day that Jesus would come. Isaac, Jacob, Jonah, whoever, they all looked for the day that Jesus would come. They had made this idea, we're followers of Moses. We're disciples of Moses. There can't be anyone else. Well, the whole Old Testament was written talking about the someone else. And there he was, right smack dab in front of them. They refuse it. And they say, no, you're in your sins. The reason this happened is you don't understand this because you're a sinner. You were born sin, and likely somebody else sinned. That's why you are blind. Get out of here. We're not listening to a word you have to say. What qualification? You didn't go to seminary. You don't know the Old Testament. You don't know Moses. And they disrespect him and they throw him out. And normally you might think that that would kind of be the end of the story, except the story picks up again in verse 35. Jesus went and found him. Because, I've already told you this, but because the best miracle hasn't happened yet. The blind seeing, it was a wonderful miracle, a fantastic miracle. Only God could do it. I'm not suggesting it wasn't fantastic. But the best miracle is yet to come. And he goes and he finds this guy. Verse 35, when they'd thrown him out. When he found him, he said, Jesus said, do you believe in the Son of Man? By the way, last summer we talked a little bit about this Son of Man title, and it comes from the book of Daniel and Ezekiel, and they talk about Son of Man, and we know that the Son of Man doesn't just mean his humanity. The Son of Man was described in the Old Testament as being a description of the Messiah. The Son of Man meant he was also the Messiah of the world. To say you are, do you believe in the Son of Man, is saying, do you believe in the Messiah? Do you believe I'm the one? And he goes, well, who is he? Verse 36. Tell me so that I may believe in him. And then these marvelous words happen. Jesus says, well, you have now seen him. I opened your eyes physically so that among the first things you would see would be the Son of Man, the Messiah, the Promised One. I opened your eyes so that you could look face to face in the one sent from God to rescue people from their sins. And this man goes from description of, first he calls him, verse 11, first he says, the man they call Jesus made some mud. That was his first description of Jesus. And then a little bit later in verse 17, he describes him as a prophet. He must be a prophet. Well, who do you think he was? Well, he says, I think he was a prophet. And then he seems to be moving towards a little bit stronger understanding of who he is. Because the Jews acknowledged in verse 22 that Jesus, anybody that acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. So he's leaning towards the fact that he was, and but he's still not sure who he is. And he goes, do you believe in the Son of Man? And he goes, well, who is he? And he goes, now I've seen him. And in fact, Jesus says, you're speaking to him now. And then, what's the final word? The final word that the blind man uses to describe Jesus. He goes from saying, his name is Jesus, he's a prophet. Jesus says, I'm the Son of Man. And now here's what this man calls Jesus. What is it? Verse 38. Then the man said, mark your Bible. Then the man said, what's the first word that comes out of his mouth? Lord.
What did Thomas say when he saw the resurrected Jesus? My Lord and my God. This is an amazing title. This is a personal surrender moment for him. This is an acknowledgement. You're God. I'm not. I needed you. You're the Lord. You're the Messiah. I believe in you. This is his salvation moment. This is the moment when he was born again. This is the best miracle in the whole story. He's come from God to change his spiritual sight so that he could now see Jesus. It's one thing to heal a man physically. It's another thing to heal him spiritually. And that's what Jesus does for this man. And he says, Lord, I believe. And then he worshiped him. And in a very real sense, we all also have to come to this moment where we come to grips with who Jesus is. And you can't just say, well, his name was Jesus. I believe that there was a man named Jesus. Well, so did this man up to this point. Well, I believe he was a prophet. Well, so did this man up to this point. And some people come to our church and they go, I just don't understand. What's my next step? Like, what am I supposed to do? I'm coming to church. Like, I just have never really felt the thing happen. I'm waiting for it to happen to me. It's like, God's going to drop this thing and I'm going to feel something. I don't know. I'm not sure you're going to feel anything. It's a decision you have to make in your heart. And God, the Holy Spirit's going to help you come to that conclusion. But at the end of the day, every one of us needs to say this very same thing. Oh, Lord, I believe. And I worship you. That, dear friends, might be the next step for some of the people listening to this talk today. You may need to declare him to be the Lord and Savior of your life. And the final question, is it possible that we're blind too? That this blind man is a picture of the condition of some of us here today. 2 Corinthians 4, Paul says this, and if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of believers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servant for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, let the light shine out of darkness, has made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Jesus Christ. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 6, if your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. And if the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Our eyes are the entrance of light to our bodies. Our spiritual eyes are the entrance of light to our souls. And Jesus wants every one of his followers to have good eyes, spiritual eyes. Eyes to see his glory and his majesty. Eyes to see, even when I don't understand, why suffering happens in this world. I still believe he's still God. And I will not continue to walk in darkness. Have you had your spiritual vision restored by Jesus? Have you been really born a second time? And if you have, do you realize that you're supposed to let him show through you so that others could know him too? Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. How does the song end? Was blind, but now I see. Let's pray together. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our eyes. Open the eyes of our hearts. Help us to see you. Help us to get a picture of your greatness, your holiness, that you are the Son of Man. You're the Messiah, the promised one, the Savior of the world. I pray, Lord, for anyone here today who's never really crossed the line of faith and made him Lord. Like, that's it. It's not just Jesus. He's in charge. He's the boss. I'm surrendering to him today as my Lord and Savior. And friend, if that's you, run to him right now by faith. Call on him. You can do it right now, right there where you're sitting. Ask him. Take away your sins. Be your Savior. And he will. And then tell us about it. Take that little communication card there and tell us, today I committed my life to Christ. And then you, on your way out, just stop by the Next Steps room. Just hand them the card and say, could I have one of those Bible study books Pastor Chip's always talking about? We'll give you one free of charge, and you can just begin your journey. Or drop it in the box, and we'll be happy to mail one to you, whatever works for you. And Christian friend, will you please keep your eyes open? They're open. Jesus opened them. Don't walk by needy people along the side of life for you who need the grace of God in their lives. Let us look for these opportunities while there's still time. And use our church, our Father, to accomplish eternal destiny changes in the hearts of many people. We pray in his name. Amen. This song is a great summary of what we've learned today.
To the darkness I was, rejected and cut off from hope. I couldn't see his love for me. They said he's not who he seems. Don't get your hopes up for him. The lies fell away when I saw his face. My heart burst to life. I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. My whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me. Now I know whose I am. Forever I'll stand on your truth. I believe, 'cause I was blind, but now daylight for me. Joy is the song that I sing. All of my days are filled with your praise. All of my days are filled with your praise. My heart burst to life. I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. That burns inside of me. Now I know whose I am. Forever I'll stand on your truth. I believe, 'cause I was blind, but now I see. No one could ever take my song away. Were opened and I saw his face. No one could ever take my flame, my faith. My life was changed the day that Jesus came. No one could ever take my song away.
heaven and I saw his face. No one could ever take away my faith. My life was changed the day that Jesus came.
Just a couple of words before we're dismissed. Our Facebook has been talking about it, our ads on Facebook. Out in the foyer, you might see some signs that talk about May 14th and 15th. We're going to be hosting Cedarville University here on our campus. May 14th is a Saturday night, 6:30. All who register get a free T-shirt. How about that for a good deal? And there will be drawings given for scholarships for any future students. Dr. Thomas White, the president, will be here. He'll share a message. The student worship team will be here. They'll be leading us in worship. It'll be almost like a mini church service there. It's a gathering for alumni, prospective students, and anybody who just wants to worship God. So that's Saturday night, 6:30 on May 14th. You need to register. It's free. You can get there through our website, or Cedarville has a link on their website. I think we're up to 150 or 175 people already registered, so should be a great night, and I wanted to let you know about that. Don't forget about the baptism tonight, and certainly want you to be a part of that. I think we've got about 20 students and 4 adults tonight who will be baptized, and there was one other thing I was going to say. Oh, the Easter offering, that's right. I knew what I was going to say. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for making sacrificial gifts to make our Easter offering the total. Some money is still trickling in, and I don't know when we'll send the check off, but very, very soon. So if you do want to add a gift today, you can put it there, mark it Easter or Ukraine offering. But here's the total. $111,112. It was 11111, and somebody added a dollar, so we made it a two. Hallelujah. Somebody's going to get some love in Jesus' name because of your gifts. And we'll keep you posted as we hear results of those gifts. So let's stand, please. And we thank God for his faithfulness to us. And my prayer for us today as we go from this place is found from Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 18. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance to the saints. Have a great week. See you next Sunday.